to me, this is a wonderful day in history in Nashville, Tennessee. I am so happy. So many wonderful things are going on right now at this moment. Fort Negley, there's happenings today, and in Franklin, Tennessee, I'm amazed at the new statue that's going in downtown Franklin. As a young girl that grew up in South Nashville but moved to Williamson County, who was had a shy personality but a passion for her history, who used to get in trouble in school for standing up for what I believe in, I am just so happy. I had a choice to be there or here, but I'm so happy I'm here. History is so important. It was very hard as a shy child to speak up. I remember one time somebody put like a little casket on my desk with a little noose on it. I said, wait a minute, who put this on my desk? Why did you do that? What did I ever do to you? I said, we have to love each other. So I teach love and kindness. I don't know why I went there, but I did. History is so important. I'm so glad you're here. This is Reverend Thompson, who is going to pray for this area. He's actually the Bass Street Community Pastor now. We have some descendants here as well. Yes. We want you to join us if you don't mind. Reverend Scrub.
Put your hands in water.
Thank you. Are there any other descendants?
Any other descendants of the area?
Of the area? You okay with joining us? We're going to start off with prayer, and we're going to call the names of the our ancestors who are here, and we're going to also welcome anyone who would like to speak to say a few words. We'll do the thank yous a little later. So many people who made this possible. Okay.
Let me just say thank you all for what you're doing in capturing history and encapsulating it, because too many times history is just wiped out for the sake of advancement or tomorrow, and we throw away yesterday. And so thank you so much for holding on to it for us. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you now, Lord, as we come together on this day. We thank you for each and every one here. And the desires you've placed upon their heart, Lord God. We ask, Master, that something, that greatness will come forth from this. And we ask, Father God, that you will bless the heads of this, Father, this assignment that you've laid before them. We thank you, Lord God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And so now, there's a couple of folks who actually lived in the area and know the area, if you guys don't mind sharing.
Well, I'm going to start off. I'm a Brother Scruggs here. He's a little bit older than me, so he got a whole lot more history for us, where my grandparents and where I lived at, and more about what took place over here in this area.
Okay.
But as my name is Philip Minter, and growing up, I live right across the street right there where that pole is. I grew up right there at 614 Bass Street.
Awesome.
And down that alley, we called it, it's called Short Street, it's called Vine Street now, but we called it Short Vine, because it was really an alley. But I had, my grandparents lived up here. We had a double outhouse that everyone in this, on this side of the street, had to use that bathroom, so, until they built houses across the street. So that took place, and as a kid, I played all back up and through there. That was my, how you say it, my stomping grounds. So that's where I played at. And this right here was where the church was at. And my grandfather, he was a deacon here at the church with no legs. So, and as growing up, I have followed in his footsteps. And now I'm a deacon at Bass Street. So, and I'm still a member of Bass Street Church. All the way up until I was 10 years old.
Were you born in the house?
Yes. And then we had to, when they brought the interstate through, we all had to move. The church had to move. We moved up on 12th Avenue. And then from 12th Avenue, we moved out to Brick Church Pike.
Yeah.
But Brother Scruggs, he got a little bit more history than I do.
Nice to see you, Brother Scruggs.
Okay, my name is Bernie Scruggs. Actually, I grew up with his parents. and at the time, like you said, his grandfather was the deacon here, man, and he was a double amputee. And some kind of remarkable way, when the church was first built, it was just a dugout here. They put a basement. We had service in the basement for years, up until around the early 40s. In the early 40s, we all went over to another location on First Avenue while they built the upper part of the church. Then we all came back here, but that was all in the early 40s. I don't remember exactly what year it was. I was young then too. Well, anyway, like I said, when they built the upper part, they had some tall steps you had to come up to go over the basement into the main part of the church. His grandfather, with no legs, would roll down this hill with his wheelchair to the foot of the steps, sit on the steps, scoot himself up the steps with a wheelchair in one arm. Until he got to the top, he'd go and go, and then he'd get back in the wheelchair. And I mean, and I always looked at it was always so remarkable to me to see how strong it is. And he was stocky built, but he had big arms. He had to be strong, in order to do that. But he never missed the service. He was always at home to service up all the time. And at that time, I mean, Mastery just kept. We kept going, and we didn't have to worry about parking back then, because nobody had cars. Everybody walked. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. it was basically all a local membership, but some people lived quite a distance, because my family lived on Second Avenue. Wow. There were other people living on First Avenue. A lot of people lived around on Seventh, down on Ewing, and a lot of other places. But that was how we started, and from there, like you said, when we had to relocate, we went on 12th Avenue, mm-hmm. Stayed on 12th until our last relocation.
Brother Scruggs, tell them what my granddaddy cut hair.
That's nothing. He had a barbershop right up on the hill beside the house.
With no legs, now, remember that.
That's right, and he was on a hill.
It was just a kind of a walkway. He had to roll himself up this hill just to get to his house. And they had they bought houses all along there. Mm-hmm. And our playing ground, he came along a little bit after we did. Our playing ground was the fort. We couldn't wait for Sunday school to be out on Sunday morning, and our whole bunch of kids just run up and explore the fort. And everything was on the fort at that time. Even some old cannons and old mini balls, all kinds of war stuff was still strewn all over the place. And little by little, they kind of cleaned it up and took it over to the museum.
Who taught you about the fort?
Well, at the time, I just kind of grew up. We talked about it in the school, mostly school. And my parents, they mm-hmm. told me about the fort.
That's excellent. Where did you go to school?
Cameron School.
Oh, yeah.
Well, at that time, that was the only school in this neighborhood you could go to besides Cartlance. Cartlance is down on 12th Avenue. And then we had a couple of other local schools. But Cameron was called the junior high, because mm-hmm. he went from the first grade to the 10th grade.
My aunt and my mother went to Cameron.
Okay.
And I went to Falls School.
Falls School,
8th Avenue,
Hillside, Chestnut.
Yeah, 8th and Chestnut.
Fall was over, he went to school with my kids. they started, well, my oldest son, Fall wasn't open, he started it at the Cameron Annex in Johnson. Wow. Now they call it Cameron Annex, but it was actually built, named after Cameron's old principal. They died in 1949, then they built another elementary school named the Johnson.
Were you born here?
Yes.
And your family settled here?
Yes, my family came here in 1920.
Wow.
And I was born in 1933.
Wow. Where did they come from in 1930?
They came from Rutherford County. Mm-hmm. Somewhere around Smyrna, the Smyrna area, between Laverne and Smyrna, a place called Sand Hill.
I do know. Mm-hmm. Okay. Anyone have any questions for him?
I mean, so many, but I'm not gonna ask them now.
Can he tell us a little bit about if there were other black businesses and how economically the community was tied, and also if any other institutions came out of the church, like maybe schools and things of that sort? That would be very interesting to know. And what kind of work did the people do? Where did they have to go to work or whatever? What was their life like? What was the social life on the Saturday night?
One at a time.
I know, I'm asking right, just answer two questions. I'm with anyone.
Well, in social life, most people, most of the local people around here in the black community, most of them were people who were very high educated. They were mostly just labor, plain workers, they were laundry workers, things like that, just plain common work.
Yeah, because my grandfather, he cleaned bricks. Mm-hmm. He cleaned bricks for a living.
Yeah, that.
Because he didn't have no legs, so he could outdo two or three men cleaning bricks.
Did someone make the bricks?
You did have a lot of people that worked in construction.
You what?
It worked in construction work. Some of them were regular labor, some were actually masons, like stone masons, some were brick masons.
So they did concrete work. What was it like on a holiday in this neighborhood?
On a holiday, you probably went to the park, which was Hadley Park or Napier Park.
Oh, they were still,
that's
cool.
So that was the 4th of July, and what was Christmas like?
Christmas was always fun. You went out and cut your Christmas tree and had Christmas at home.
you go up in the fort and cut your Christmas tree down and call it
anywhere,
Christmas.
Anywhere you can find a cedar tree to chop down.
So what was Christmas morning like for an average African-American child, let's say growing up when you were in the 1950s?
Well,
what was Christmas morning like?
For me, I mean, some children were taught different. My folks never told me that was a Santa Claus. I mean, we looked at Santa Claus as if it was a part of Christmas. I mean, for part of Christmas
Day, you mean your parents didn't let a white man get but
we didn't celebrate it as Santa Claus Day. We called it Santa Claus, but I knew it wasn't no Santa Claus. A lot of my neighbors got mad at me because I go around and tell those kids what my Santa Claus was. In fact, I got sent home a lot of times for that because my folks never told me it was a Santa Claus. We knew about, not in the sense of somebody that just brought you presents. We knew you. Well, I always knew my parents bought my presents. But it was always good. It was always a fun day.
No other social activities, no dances, no musicians, anything.
When you talk about social activities, I don't know what you're talking about. Just general people are talking about just the church itself. I mean, a lot of the members here, they didn't go, but that was a beer garden right there on that corner called Rock Garden.
Rock Garden.
Well, we called it a beer garden. It wasn't a little place where people went and drank beer and got drunk on Saturday night.
Well, we called this music city. Was any music going on?
It was, and when we tried to have, because back then churches would have a lot of services during the weeknights, and on weeknights we have problems trying to hold our service because all we could have the jukebox down at Rock Garden. It was just right down the corner where the great building is.
And when I grew up, I lived right there. That building right there, that's where the high school kids used to skate at. That was a skating rink. They would take the walnuts out, and on Friday nights, all the high school kids would, you know, they would skate. That was the skating ring right there. Outdoor skating ring.
It was really a walnut house.
They took the walnuts out and let the kids come in there and skate.
By the time you grew up, they done tore down Rock Garden.
Yeah.
The Rock Garden sit right next door to it.
So there was play, although people worked hard. They went to church. They sent their children to school. What was your school like? What was the classroom like?
Classroom was barely the same.
I mean, were the two rooms
full? No, not here, not in Nashville. I mean, you had those big one room schools out in the counties, but here we had just regular modern schools.
Okay.
Now we had secondhand books, but we had modern schools.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else?
We truly appreciate you so much, mm-hmm. you guys, for sharing your stories. They're very important, and I'm sure that there'll be other questions later, and they might want to document the stories as well. And if you know other people, we would like to know who they are as well. Mm-hmm. I know that I feel like my grandmother, I had to kind of pull things out of her because there were so many painful moments, but she always concentrated on the happy moments. Oh, okay. And so I wanted to know the stories that weren't so happy, like especially during the 60s and the sit-ins and all that sort of thing. So just share your stories with someone you trust to keep them. And I appreciate you so much, especially important now in Nashville, because a lot of those buildings are gone. A lot are gone. Thank you so much.
People are books. If you just listen, people are books.
Absolutely. I agree. This is my friend Fatia. She's going to tell you a little bit about her. So
we've known each other a while.
You're right. Long time. 30.
Right.
Well, don't date us. Date yourself. Right. She just had a birthday. Come on. I have one coming up.
Landmark birthday, but. Morning, everyone. My name is Fatia Shepherd Suso. Organization is called the World Afrocultural Community Project, which is a child of the African American Cultural Alliance and African Street Festival. One of the projects that we are working on, I love this event. I'm so happy to have heard your stories. They are extremely important and necessary to preserve. One of the projects that I am embarking on is giving placement to where the historical contributions and stories of African descendants can be shared publicly, which is in the Jubilee Bridge area in North Nashville, and an area that I'm calling a Black Heritage Walk, which will be a greenway combination. Still working on it, but it's gonna happen. It needs to happen. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so now we're going to call the names. We do a little ceremony where we invite the ancestors here. And we're going to, as it is, amen, we say Ashe after we call a name. And it's just a way to acknowledge their presence. And the first time I came here, I still feel them. But the first time I came here, the energy was so high for me. I can feel the energy of the land. And I feel like that land is being healed. Fort Negley as well as this land, because so much had happened here that was unpleasant, but I feel like the land has actually been healed. So we're gonna call the names, and after each name or family group, we'll say Ashe. You wanna practice? Can everybody say Ashe?
Ashe.
Perfect.
Robert Weekly.
Ashe.
George Green and family. His children were Sally, Edward, John, and Abraham.
Ashe.
It was a boarder named William Stevenson.
Ashe.
The William Holman family.
Ashe.
Wife Millie. Children Paralee, White Maria, Amanda, Cordelia, Thomas, Annie, and Emma.
Big family.
Ashe.
Thomas Perkins and family. Children were Pate, Mary, Daniel, Pauline, and Sally.
Ashe.
And his wife, Paralee.
Ashe.
Tobias, unsure of the last name. Wife, Annie. Son, Luther.
Ashe.
Caleb Williams and family, his mother Lizzie, daughter Annie, son Roger.
Ashe.
Ernest Andrews and family, wife Lula, children Laura, Oz, Anna, Eunice, and Gilbert.
Ashe.
Unsure of the first name, last name Russell, the Russell family, wife Emma, and daughter Melvina.
Ashe. Now I welcome you to call the names of those that you would like to acknowledge here on this property. It doesn't have to be anyone who's tied to the land. It could be anyone of your loved ones who you want to acknowledge. And I want to acknowledge Kwame Leo Lillard. I want to acknowledge my parents. I am grandparents. I won't call all their names. But, there's plenty of family here. Ashe.
I would like to acknowledge Fanny and William Hall that actually lived up on this hill. Had 8 children.
Wow.
Ashe.
Anybody else?
I want to acknowledge my